watching me. Okay, well, here we are in part 5, chapter 4. It gets a little confusing because we did an introduction that wasn't over any chapter. Chapter 4 of Live Not by Lies by Rod Dreher. Just a kind of little bit of a recap. We've been looking at how totalitarian societies develop, what they look like, how they work. That our current society seems to have many characteristics of a pre-totalitarian society. We've looked at how not all totalitarian societies necessarily have to be a top-down, brutal, cruel government control sort of thing, that actually there's a idea of soft totalitarianism, which would be like culturally enforced, kind of the bottom up through cultural institutions, not government policy and politics. And we see that the dominant ideology in many of our institutions is actually the religion of progressivism, the social justice kind of dogma. And so things kind of seem to be fallen in line to lead us that way. And so that's what we have been looking at. Are there any questions, thoughts over anything of previous sessions, previous chapters, before we get running with tonight's topic? No? Okay. Well, tonight we're dealing with chapter 4, which we do not appear to be live. Well, it's still going like it's live. But, okay. Not sure what the deal is there. It's bizarre. It is being recorded, so if needed to, I can edit and post a video later. Apologies to those attempting to watch online. The question we kind of got to look at is, all right, so you have these elements within our society that are kind of setting the stage for, lending themselves towards totalitarianism. Question kind of have to ask is, do they have the means to actually impose a totalitarian society on us? This is America. We even still do tend to be rather averse to government control, despite how the government has expanded. There's at least still a decent ethos, I think, in our culture of people who, if the government pushes too hard, too fast, react with, whoa, hold on a second, time out. And then we actually think the Constitution and the laws mean something. And so that would be difficult. However, they don't need to force control on us politically whenever we kind of hand it over to them willingly, oftentimes in the name of liberty, which is odd. We kind of give them control so that we can feel some kind of liberty. So if this totalitarianism is not at least initially going to come through the government, where is it going to come from? The answer to that in the book is, and I think what we see going on, is through business, financing, banking, investing, that sort of thing. What's really interesting is, I remember being a kid, and it's like I read a lot of sci-fi, And a lot of the futuristic, dystopian, science fiction stories and things had governments were subservient to big international, multinational, global corporations. And I actually kind of seem to be heading that way to some degree. A few little statistics here. Walmart has more annual revenue than Spain and more than two times the revenue of Russia. ExxonMobil has more revenue than India, Norway, or Turkey. And Apple has more cash on hand than two-thirds of the world's nations. That's pretty impressive economic power, which oftentimes the economic power is really how a lot of things will get done. So in the past, a lot of times in America, we would count on kind of corporations, companies, business, almost as a an offset to government power, right? Because businesses didn't want government getting too involved in stuff because they wanted their freedom to do their business and make their profits. And so that was usually kind of a good counter to government, except now it appears business, finance industry has gotten to the point where it actually is not only kind of a stopgap, but can be more powerful than. And so, and now, whereas in the past businesses were typically hands off when it came to politics, more concerned with profit than with social issues and political issues, unless it directly affected their profits. Now we actually are seeing businesses and corporations taking political and cultural stands and even pushing cultural things. And so, why is it, do you think, that businesses are getting involved? Any thoughts? Or anyone, if you did the reading? They want an orderly business, so they want to be able to tell the public what to buy, when to buy, where to buy. Yeah. That's a pretty good deal if you can actually kind of make people have to buy your stuff, you know. You know, like, yeah, health insurance. I mean, that's, hey, you want to go to the doctor? We're picking where you have to go. You know, hey, there's a virus. We're the only show in town that has a treatment. So let's make sure you have to take it. And so, yeah, that's one reason. But what's weird is some of it isn't, you know, like some of those you can at least connect the dots and you go, okay, I mean, you're doing that so that you get enriched. But there's things where there's no direct profit understood. Like whenever, was it Major League Baseball, that whenever Georgia passed a law to help secure elections and prevent fraud, Major League Baseball said, oh, that's horrible. You're trying to discriminate and, you know, rig elections. And so we're out of here. And they pulled And so, which oddly enough, they moved it to a state that had worse, you know, more discriminatory laws than, or at least what they would term to be discriminatory laws than what Georgia did. Where's the business thing in that? I mean, it actually cost money to have to move, you know, a series or a game. You have Disney, whenever Florida came out and said, hold on, time out. How about we don't teach sex and sexual things to little kids? Disney came out against that. Why is a movie and theme park company jumping into the ring on a political issue about sex in schools? I mean, that definitely turned out to not probably be quite so profitable for them, but they don't seem to care about the profit. So there's certain things where you can see, oh, that's why they did that, because that's gonna help pad their bottom line. But we see them doing things that actually go the opposite way. It's actually almost a cliche, the idea of go woke, get broke, or get woke, go broke, right? That these companies, they come out and they throw in with all this woke social justice stuff, and they have customers just start jumping ship and going, no, I ain't doing business with you. And so it's actually not a profitable thing. Yeah. And you know, I think there's a lot of people that just really have no idea any of this is going on. I mean, I have the benefit of working a day job where my mind doesn't have to be fully engaged in my task at hand. So I'm constantly listening to podcasts and audiobooks and news and all this kind of stuff. And so I'm hearing about all this sort of things that are going on. But you know, whenever that wasn't the case, getting up in the morning, okay, maybe I have a 15, 20 minute drive where I'm listening to the radio, and I might listen to news or I might listen to music, you know? But then I get to work and I'm working. And on my lunch break, I don't know, maybe I listen to something, maybe not. Maybe, you know, I just sit and eat my lunch or go eat lunch with a coworker or a friend. Get home, got all the family stuff to do and all that, you know, maybe catch the evening news. When is your regular, you know, 9-to-5 schlub getting all the information and know what's going on? They don't. So not only would they not know why it's going on, they may not even know that it's going on. And so, but here are some reasons why it appears that businesses are getting involved in the political or culture war, you know, issues. One is the activism in universities. For years, I mean, it's always been the case, I forget who the saying came from, where it's like, if you're not young and liberal, you don't have a heart. But if you're not old and conservative, then you don't have a brain. Because whenever you're young and you're pushing boundaries and you're trying to figure out everything and, you know, you got all your emotions going, and it's natural to, you know, be pulled by those, you know, kind of social causes. You know, but the general thing was always accepted that, well, you know, they'll get out there in the real world and that'll wake them up real quick and they'll lose all that. That may have been true a couple decades ago. But at least in the last decade or so, it's not just liberal ideas, but it's rather these extreme radical Marxist, we've done studies on that in the past, these ideas that, you know, it's not just teaching them ideas, but it's encouraging, demanding activism. That it's not enough that you believe it, it's not enough that you think it, you must be doing it. And if you're not doing it, you're no better than those people. And so this idea of activism is just drilled in. And whenever you also have the cultural issues we've been having of listlessness and hopelessness, people feeling without meaning or purpose, they grab onto this. It's not something they shed whenever they leave university. They're bringing it into the workplace. And then as they get leadership positions, they're bringing it in there. There is, I was gonna get a clip, but I didn't have the time to find it and edit it out to be able to show you. In a conversation that I heard on a podcast, there was a commentator, he's not conservative by any means, but he was talking with the heads of Twitter at the time, Jack Dorsey and I forget the name of the lady who was actually like in charge of Twitter's, you know, community guidelines, kind of, you know, safety board, whatever they call it. And the point that he was making to them, and they just would not register, is that Twitter's guidelines are biased against conservative ideology. And the example he gave was on the transgender issue and the use of pronouns. Because in Twitter's guidelines, it says you're not allowed to misgender someone. And he pointed out, you realize that according to conservatives, if you take someone who was born biologically a man and you call him a her, that is misgendering because his gender is him, not her. But it's the progressive view that if someone says, I'm a her, even though it's really a him, for you to call her a him, Now you're misgendering. See, the progressive ideology is built into their terms and conditions. And they just wouldn't see it. Well, no, no, we just don't want hateful things said. Well, no, see, your whole idea of how you're doing this is based on you have this view. And so what it is so part of it is that you do have people who have been indoctrinated in this, and now they're in positions where they get to set these standards. And they really, some of them are true believers, where they just really are on board with this stuff. And it would seem weird, right? 10 years ago, if you would have said that to me, I'd have been like, that's never going to happen, right? Business is about making money. Well, now you got some of these social justice true believers in positions of authority in businesses and corporations. So there's that. However, you also have ESG scores. I may have mentioned, may have talked a little bit about it. Y'all familiar with what ESG is? Here's a short video to show you what and explain to you what ESG is, and to be sure that I'm not just, you know, given some kind of bias thing, I went and found not a, you know, conservative anti-ESG, you know, video to show you. So here's this.
ESG stands for Environmental, Social and Governance and can help you invest more responsibly. The idea is that by using these three factors to determine where you put your money, your financial choices can have a more positive and sustainable impact on the world. The environmental factor covers issues around climate change, such as what a company is doing to reduce its carbon footprint, pollution and the use of natural resources. It also looks at opportunities in clean tech and renewable energy. The social factor is about how companies treat their employees, workers across their supply chain, and the communities that they work in. This can cover issues of sweatshop labour, human rights, and diversity in the workplace. This also looks at opportunities in areas such as healthcare or affordable housing. The governance factor focuses on how well a company is run for the long-term benefit of all its stakeholders, from how decisions at the top are made to executive pay and the strength of social and environmental oversight. Considering a company's ESG performance can help ensure your investment is helping rather than harming the world.
So there's your quick rundown of ESG. And, you know, just passing by, it's like, okay, well, I mean, that sounds, you know, you don't want to be irresponsible. Well, one thing you have to understand, one thing we've talked about many times, is the problem is a lot of times these ideologies, they use words that are common to you, but they use them in a way where they mean something else. Or they use them in such a vague way that anything can kind of be slipped in. So let's look at a few. First off, on when it comes to environmental, that a company is going to be given a score, right? We're used to credit scores, how financially stable and how, you know, financially robust are they, and so you get a score. Well, this is a score that rates you on things like environment considerations. For instance, climate change, and are you tackling global warming? If you've got a company making widgets, I don't care what you're doing about global warming. Do you make a good widget? That's what I want to know. Do you do so at an affordable price, right? Those are the typical kind of concerns. This says, no. See, we're going to rate your the way you're addressing climate change and global warming issues. Are you producing too much? Are you not using enough recycled things? Are you not, you know, that sort of deal? It also mentions, are you using renewable energies? Which is interesting because, so if you're not using solar and wind and that sort of thing, if you're using too much fossil fuels, then that's a lower score, which automatically means that certain industries are going to have a lower score because of what they do and who they are that naturally need the fossil fuels. So it's that right there. It's an ideology built into it, not based on your business, but based on how are you matching up with our view of climate change and climate responsibility. When it comes to the S on social issues, right, is that one of the things it mentions is human rights. How is your company doing on human rights? See, now, if what is meant by this is, right, you're not using slave labor, right? You're not, you know, saying, yeah, we don't want any of you dark-skinned people working here, right? I mean, if you're, you know, if you're not abusing people, if you're, you know, if that sort of thing is like, well, okay, yeah, we want companies to not be mean to people. We want companies to not, you know, mistreat people and discriminate, that sort of thing. But who decides what rights are human rights? Because right now we have people telling us that transgenderism, that if they're born a woman but now say they're a man, that is a human right. And if you're not affirming that you're somehow violating their rights. So whose ideology actually gets to define what human rights means? Big area there. And then it says, is there diversity in the workplace? That if you have a more diverse workplace, you have a higher score. Well, I mean, now if what you mean is that you got more people of different shades of color, that you're not, you know, excluding people on basis of, you know, race or ethnicity or that sort of thing. But as we've talked about in past things, when it comes to the whole social justice idea of diversity, it's not merely that there's a diverse amount of people or a diverse kind of people, but it's this weird Orwellian doublespeak where diversity doesn't actually mean diversity. Where diversity means that everybody's of the same mind, the same ideology, pushing the same thing. Because have you noticed that in certain instances where black people don't count as black? In California, whenever they had the governor race here recently, the main challenger to the governor out there was a gentleman by the name of Larry Elder, a black man, who was called the black face of white supremacy because he doesn't have the right idea. So whenever you say diversity in the workplace, do you mean like actual diversity, or do you mean the social justice, critical race theory, twisted, messed up garbage view of diversity? See, that matters. And then this is what they're saying businesses will be ranked on. What's interesting is they also throw in here healthcare and affordable housing. I'm trying to figure out what your widget factory's got to do with healthcare and affordable housing. Is it that you provide healthcare to your employees? What's really interesting, I remember the first time I had someone tell me, I'd never work somewhere that doesn't give me health insurance. I'm like, I'd be glad if they do give me some, but I never considered it my boss's responsibility to pay for my healthcare. That's weird to me. You know, I mean, hey, you know, awesome. You want to wrap that up in your benefits package? Great. I actually had a boss one time that I said, I'm young, I'm healthy, I never get sick, right? How about instead of you paying me health insurance, can I just get that in my check? And he said, sorry, it doesn't work like that. We have to pay for the group. But okay, now that's a different ideology. So whose ideology about social things is actually getting to rank the businesses here? Well, it's the social justice ideology. When it comes to governance, generally speaking, the idea of corporate structure, I mean, you have to dig into what is meant by that. That's nice and vague. Do you have the right kind of corporate structure? They mention, you know, payment for, you know, top people. I know it's rather obscene the amount of money that some of these executives make. Personally, I'm like, if you can juggle a global business and, you know, work 80, 90 hours a week and do all this and help it be profitable, and the board and the shareholders think you're worth that much, ain't none of my business. If you're getting the job done, that's a really unique skill set that not many people could actually manage. So sure, get paid a whole bunch more for it. It gets to a point where you think, all right, being kind of greedy there, but hey, why is it my business if you're getting it done? So there is that issue. That's a different of ideology there, though. That's got nothing to do with actual ranking of business. But what caught me was this part where it says, for the long-term benefit of stakeholders. Now, typically, whenever we think of businesses, we think they need to be working for the benefit of their shareholders, the people who have actually invested in the company and are expecting a return on their investment. This word stakeholder, this is what's called stakeholder capitalism, that you're not responsible just to your investors and your shareholders, the people who have paid into the company. No, 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 you're responsible to anyone at all that your company might impact or influence. Well, that could be the community you're sitting in. That can be, you know, customers in far-flung places. If it's a big company, that can be anyone, anywhere that is in any way even remotely related to your company or anything you do, depending on how far you want to stretch that. So, and then lastly, this little bit where it says that make sure investments are helping rather than harming the world. Well, who gets to decide what counts as helping and who gets to decide what counts as harming? See, this whole thing of ESG is built on social and political ideology. So it's really a rating system, not of your business and how it's performing, but is, do you have the right ideology? Do you think the right way? And do you act on those right beliefs that we think it should be? And so this is actually being implemented. This is already massive companies, investing firms, the big global international things have been doing it for years. Chances are, if you bank with or have investments with a big international or even national, probably maybe even just really big state level even finance firm, investment firm, bank, you probably have an ESG score. It hasn't really trickled down to the personal level yet to really be implemented. Right now, it's just business and banks, especially on the big end of things. But it doesn't take much for that to get down to the personal level, where now ESG is working the same way your credit score does. Whereas your credit score, as ranked by the big three, have to do with your debt. Are you borrowing money? How much money have you borrowed? What's your ratio? Do you pay back what you know, all that kind of stuff? Only this ranks you on your ideology and how are you behaving according to their ideology. And so if ESG aligns with a particular ideology, then it's going to influence companies, because companies that have a high ESG score are going to be more likely, more able to get investing opportunities, lower interest rates, and all that kind of stuff. Whereas if you have a low ESG score because you're not properly woke, then you'll have opportunities cut off. And so even non-ideological businesses would have incentive to go along with the woke stuff in order to be able to get the investing they need in order to be able to function on perhaps a level they would like to. And so, any thoughts, questions on ESG and how this motivates companies to get political and dive in the culture war? Yeah, I don't know, hadn't heard about that. Which, that is one of the most disgusting things on two levels. For a company to say, hey, ladies, if your state doesn't allow you to kill your baby, then we will pay for you to go somewhere else that will let you kill your baby. That's disgusting. First, on one hand, that it's helping people kill their babies. But on the other hand, do they really think this is motivated by care for the woman? Because if you got a business deal, it's like, okay, I can pay a couple $1,000s for her to go across the state line and get that taken care of, and then she's back at work. Or I can pay all the health care stuff needed for the pregnancy and the delivery and the maternity time away and all that kind of stuff. Hey, better bottom line, go kill that baby. Which is actually incentivizing. I just, the whole thing's messed up all around. This will kind of come back around full circle here in a minute. So, any other thoughts or anything on ESG? It's kind of starting to trickle down a little bit. I've seen people who have said, you know, I went to check on my, you know, 401k, and I have an ESG score. You know, and so some banks, some institutions, probably especially the big, you know, multinational ones, are starting to put that on the lower level. So, well, businesses getting political itself would be bad enough, but what about whenever the companies are actually watching and gathering information on you? That's where it really starts to get scary. One thing to think about, and I love whenever the first time I heard this, this is one of those things that whenever you hear it, like a light bulb goes off. If something is free, you are the product. They don't just give stuff away for free. They're getting something out of it, and oftentimes what they're getting out of it is you and your information. So all these wonderful apps that we love to have on our phones, buried down in there in those terms and conditions is that all this information it's gathering on you as you're using the app, as you're playing the game, they then get to sell to other people. And so we already have a massive surveillance system in place that we invited into our lives. And we tell ourselves, like, I can't live without it. Gotta have it. You understand all the stuff this thing does for me? The crazy thing is, even if you didn't invite it, even if you're like, I've been staying away from all that, I don't have any social media, they can still get you. Because you know people who are using them. One thing that's actually kind of scary is, that's kind of small, what's called shadow profiles. This is from the Telegraph. It was an article, I forget what the publication date of it was. Shadow profiles and how Facebook tracks you even when you don't have an account. Who here has a Facebook account? Who doesn't? Yes, you do. Do you have family members and friends who have them? They can make those connections. If you're in a picture, if you're in a post, if you're referenced, if you're mentioned, not just through Facebook, but also through all the information, all the other information they gather. Their algorithms cross-reference all of that. And even if you've never signed up for Facebook, chances are Facebook has an account for you, just as well as if you'd signed one up. Yeah, it'll do that. Yeah, you know, because, and I think back to whenever I'm younger, it's like you upload a picture of you with your friends, you know, and it's like, you know, who's, you know, and it does that little thing pops up and asks you, you know, who that is. And you're like, yeah, I was with Billy and I was with Joe and we're having a great time, right? And so you click on that and now all of Billy's friends get to see it and everybody's like, oh, look what a great time they were having, right? No. Now it's identifying all these things. And even if it's someone who's not on Facebook, you know, now they've got a name. And now there's that connection to you. And now, and their algorithm puts all this together and actually builds a profile. And it happens automatically. It's not like they're like, yeah, we're going to get profiles of people who are. Their algorithms are designed to collate all this information into profiles for ad revenue purposes. And so, even if you don't have an account, it's building one for you. One question that gets asked in the study guide is it fair to say that Americans are naive about sharing our information online? I think that's pretty fair to say. I think even those of us that aren't naive about it are still like, oh, but it's so useful. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, and you know, that's one thing that, yeah, and that's one thing people don't get. Like, TikTok is owned by a company from China. There are no free companies in China. Every single company in China is owned by the Communist Party. So, wow. Yeah. Well, you know, and what's interesting, because I stop and think back, okay, I got my first computer 20-something years ago, you know. And I remember it was a 33 megahertz, you know, 386, you know, with a hard drive of, I mean, come on, like 300 megabytes. How am I ever going to need 300 megabytes, right? The amount of processing power, right? I mean, we've probably all heard the, you know, thing. It's like the computer we carry around in our pocket is more powerful than the computer that took them to the moon. Yep. And so with the processing power they have, I mean, there's places they just have massive, you know, processor farms that are just crunching all this information. Yeah. And so, they gather and sort it and put it all to use. And here's the thing, we all kind of know this, right? If you have information about someone, you have some ability to manipulate them, at least on some level, right? Just simple things where, you know, it's like, say, you know, a coworker really hates Mexican food, and it's time to decide where to go to lunch, and you'd really like to go to, you know, wherever, and you know your other coworker is going to want Mexican food, so you go like, you know, hey, why don't we go get the Mexican food, making the other one go, no, I don't want any Mexican food, and all of a sudden now you got to team up against the other guy, just like that. What'd you do? You manipulated it based on what? Food preference, right? That doesn't matter anything. That's no big deal. Okay, but what if it's not food preference? What if now it's phone number, address, where you work, what you do, the political parties you follow, the people you affiliate with, the places you donate to, the associations you're involved in. Yeah, the internet is forever. And so, you know, all of that now they have on you. So, how do private corporations use technology to shape the way that we think and live? What's really funny, because my thinking on this is still outdated. Even knowing that, you know, there's more to that, I still can't wrap my mind around how advanced it is. Because there's little things that we know that, like, stores do. They know how people shop. They know what draws attention. They know, you know, the kind of music to play over their speakers to create the right kind of atmosphere, right? All this kind of stuff. We all kind of know and are used to that. They know psychological influences of ads, what kind of colors to use. You ever wonder why so many restaurants and fast food places, their signs are yellow and red? Because they know what that does mentally to you. It's a psychological thing to draw you. The way sounds, images, colors, all of this affect us, right? They already know this, so they're building it into their ads, into their technology, into the way they do things. But it goes a lot deeper than that, because they're gathering so much about us to be able to tailor their advertising to us. And so here's just, I think it's about 2 minutes or so. I have the audiobook, so I took a little clip just to give you an idea of all the ways that we may not realize that we are being tracked and monitored and information gathered.
Consider this scenario. The alarm on your smartphone by your bedside buzzes you out of bed in the morning. While you are asleep, the apps on the phone uploaded the previous day's information about your activities on it to the app owner. You crawl out of bed, brush your teeth, put on your shorts and sneakers, and take a 20-minute run around your neighborhood. The Fitbit on your wrist records your workout information and uploads it. Back home, you shower, go into the kitchen to pour yourself a bowl of cereal, and sit down at the kitchen table to check your Gmail account, Facebook, and your favorite news and information sites. Everything you write on Gmail is processed by Google, which scans the text for keywords to direct advertising to you. Everything you post, like, or forward on Facebook is recorded by the company and used in its advertising. The company's algorithms are so sophisticated now that Facebook can make detailed predictions about you just by associating certain data points. When you scan newspaper websites, cookies embedded in your browser report back about which stories you've read. As you drive to work, sensors in your car record and report your driving habits because you allowed your car insurance company to capture this data in exchange for a lower rate for safe drivers. Meanwhile, the insurance company's sensors record data about which stores you stop at, and then report all that back to the insurance company, which sells that data to marketers. All day long, the smartphone in your pocket sends data about its location, and therefore you, back to your service provider. You are trackable at all times, and disabling location services in your device is not foolproof. All the requests you make of Siri, your digital assistant, recorded and monetized. All the Google searches during the day, recorded and monetized. You go out for lunch and pay with your credit or debit card. Marketers know where you've eaten and match that data to your personal profile. Stop at the supermarket on the way home to pick up a few things and pay with the card. They know what you bought. Your smart refrigerator is sending data about your eating habits to someone. Your smart television is doing the same thing about what you're watching. Your smart television will soon be watching you, literally. Zuboff reports on prize-winning research by a company called Realize that will use facial data recognition to make it possible for machines to analyze emotions using facial responses. When this technology becomes available, your smart TV, smartphone, or laptop will be able to monitor your involuntary response to commercials and other programming and report that information to outside sources. It doesn't take a George Orwell to understand the danger posed by this all but inescapable technology.
And I'm sure there's probably much more that we're not aware of or thinking of, but so many things of our life are constantly surveilling us. One of the ways that this, and I heard this example, and I thought, wow. So, and not intentionally, there's ways that the algorithms can manipulate you without you even knowing it. So say, for instance, someone who, 10 years ago, say 2012, they're 10 years old. And let's put them a little older. Well, kids nowadays getting online that young. Let's say someone who is, 15, 10 years ago. And they're on Facebook or Twitter or whatever, and they see a video that's shared about police brutality, where there's some police beating up a black guy, and they go, "Whoa, what is that?" Click. They watch it. Now the algorithm registers that they clicked on that, and so it registers that as something they liked. Maybe they like it. Maybe they share it. And so the algorithm says, "Oh, they like this." It shows them more. So it's like, okay, police brutality video share and racism stuff shares. So now it's police brutality against black people. And so because this is what's been getting clicked on, the algorithm just gives the person more of it. Well, now fast forward 10 years, Now they're 25, they're working at a company, they're maybe in a position of management, and they have 10 years of seeing racist police brutality videos, and they have it in their mind that this is commonplace and it happens all the time all over the country, and it's horrible and despicable. And yes, police brutality, especially racist police brutality, is despicable and horrible, but it's not anywhere near as commonplace as they think it is. But their social media put it in front of them constantly. Why? Because it's what they clicked on. So it's what the algorithm thought they wanted more of. And so this is one way that these technologies can actually shape our thinking. I've seen man on the street interviews where they go around, they ask people, how many black people do you think are killed each year by police? And people answer, oh, like 3,000. What? No, it's like 12. But people, you know, probably more average people would guess, you know, around 100, maybe in the low hundreds. But you have people, you know, saying all the way up to 5,000, 10,000. Why? Well, because their social media interactions feed them all this information and make it look like that's what the world is really like. And so what was really kind of scary, so they were doing an investigation in Congress on the impact of social media, particularly Instagram, on teen girls. And here you had a senator's office created an account posing as a teenage girl, and images promoting self-harm surfaced almost immediately. Because you sign, you know, they made the account, the fake person they were signing up as met certain characteristics that the algorithm said this demographic is interested in and searches these things. So it automatically gave them to them, which means that teen girls are looking into, thinking about, searching about self-harm. But not just that they're doing it, but now we know that the social media is feeding it to them. That's affecting how they think. What's really interesting is they can do this on purpose, and I think some do, but ideology can be put forward and be given a bigger platform than it otherwise would have in society. For instance, LGBT, which is, you know, the big, loud, squeaky wheel getting all the grease, it's actually a small portion of society. But here's what's interesting. According to, this is The Guardian reporting, but they reported on a study of by Gallup, I believe was the polling, yeah. It said 7.1% of Americans identify as LGBTQ. And you're thinking, seven? How does 7% of the population basically control, you know, so much? Well, it gets even more interesting whenever you stop and you think, what is it that we're told? We're told, this is who you are. This is how you are. It's how you're born. This is, you know, that's what's pushed. That's what's told. That's what's taught. When you actually start digging into the poll, you find that 21% of Generation Z identifies as LGBTQ. One in five. And that's the current, like, young adult generation. Generation before that, Millennials, half of that, 10.5. Generation before that, Generation X, was 4.2%, a little less than half. Generation before that, Baby Boomers, about 2.6. Go back to what's called the traditionalist adults, which I think were those born in like 46, rather mid-40s, 0.8%. Now, wait a minute, I thought this is how you were born, it's who you are. Why is it increasing? Why is it like doubling every generation? Because it's a social thing that's going on. And especially in the last couple generations, as technology and social media has become such a big deal, it's really been getting pushed. And so, social development is making it happen. It might call it a social contagion, which is actually what Abigail Schreier refers to. Not her, she actually got it from a clinical person. Her book, Irreversible Damage, looking at transgenderism, particularly what's referred to as rapid onset gender dysphoria, where children, particularly young girls, preteen, prepubescent, right around puberty, all of a sudden, who have never given any indication of being transgender, all of a sudden, they're trans. And their friends are trans. And like half their class is trans. Where's all this coming from? It's a social contagion that is in part being pushed by all this technology, social media, and such. And so, what's interesting is the evidence in this book, and you know the fact that it's growing per generation, shows that this isn't a natural born thing, that it's a social thing. But you would not know that just from what the news and social media puts forward. It's affecting the way people think about these issues because only one side of the issue is getting put forward. I've mentioned before I was doing a presentation on abortion, and I wanted the number of crisis pregnancy centers. I forget what they call them now. People thought the word crisis is maybe a little too, you know, and so they've been renaming them. I forget what they call them now. But non-abortive clinics that help actually help women have their baby and care for and, you know, that kind of stuff. And I thought, I know they outnumber abortion clinics. I want to know how much. So I searched how many crisis pregnancy centers in the U.S. On Google, I didn't get anything even remotely like an answer for what I was searching until page 6. I had to go through 5.5 pages of articles showing and claiming that crisis pregnancy centers are frauds and con artists and, you know, to be avoided and how they're horrible people tricking women and manipulating. Well, Google's where everybody goes to get their answers. I think they're kind of twisting things a little bit there. Okay, oh man. So social media only shows you what you want it, what it wants you to see. There's all kinds of different ways that they can control things. There's deplatforming, refusing service to people with the wrong ideas. I'm surprised there was not a public outcry that the fact that a sitting president of the United States got banned from all social media, or at least the big ones, altogether just said, no, you're gone. The sitting president got kicked off. Why? Because he has the wrong ideas. He said the wrong things. Censoring, they don't like things, right? They just take it down. Shadow banning. This is where there's nothing that's announced or done. They just quietly don't let people find it. Back in the, was it 2020? I think it was the 2020 Democrat primary. There was an instance where Tulsi Gabbard just ripped apart Kamala Harris. I mean, just tore into her. I mean, it was embarrassing. She was the clear, like, star of that debate. After that debate, couldn't find her. You go search Google for Tulsi Gabbard, you'll find all kinds of articles about her. Can't find her campaign page, can't find her social media page. You go on YouTube and look for her, can't find her channel. Where'd she go? Everybody's searching about her, she's gone. Shadow banning. I saw a thing where the same sort of deal, I don't remember exactly what it was, but the person was searching for stuff on a particular political issue and they couldn't find it. They used a VPN to mask their source and it made it look like they were coming from some other country. They went on, searched for it, found it like that. But Americans were being blocked from seeing something that was a major political issue in our own country. How about fact-checking and warnings, right? Those of you on social media, you ever get one of those? Somebody shares a post, just to let you know, here's a misinformation warning. uh-oh, this may not be true, right? If anything even remotely has the word COVID or vaccine or virus, there's going to be a warning on there that's going to send you to the World Health Organization to explain to you everything about COVID. They want to make sure you're getting the right ideas. Okay. Now, we're short on time, but I want to show this video. It's a clip. I tried to edit it down. So I think it's just maybe a couple minutes from a news report on the fact that we're all carrying around, and a lot of people, hundreds of millions of people, have invited surveillance equipment into their home in the form of Alexa or Google. And so here's just a quick clip on that.
More than 100 million Amazon Echoes have been sold. They are now fixtures in homes.
It has become almost a member of the family.
With owners treating the voice-controlled concierge Alexa like a person.
I honestly cannot imagine not having one now. I use her that much.
Like many, Lauren Radzimiski shares a lot of information with the smart speaker and relies on the device to get news and weather, to turn on the lights,
there's a station for 80s music,
to play background music, and to keep the kitchen stocked.
Alexa, can you put tortilla chips on the shopping list?
But in the North Shore kitchen of Jenny Mitchell, you won't find an Echo.
He actually ripped it out of the wall and said, we are not using this anymore. We are done with Alexa. Clearly, she's listening to us. A few times, we were just having a normal conversation in the kitchen, and the device woke up and chimed in on the conversation, or it either misunderstood what we said or thought we were talking to the device, and in fact, we were not. We never said Alexa. So clearly, it was listening. It must have heard something that woke it up. And it kind of spooked us a little bit.
Situations like that are causing countless consumers to question internet privacy and safety in the age of all-encompassing smart devices.
Not bad. Only two meetings today.
Leading to the big question, is big tech bugging our homes?
I feel like they have the ability to.
Tech consultant Derek Heiser is a board member of the Digital Privacy Alliance, a nonprofit, nonpartisan group that advocates for online privacy and safety.
Right now, what are the regulations that govern how companies can use that information?
There are no regulations at the national level.
That means the companies themselves, like Amazon with the Echo, Google with the Assistant, and Apple with Siri, are determining how and when they record consumers, where those recordings are stored, and how they're used.
They're policing themselves at the moment.
In a written statement to WGN News, an Amazon spokesperson said, quote, Amazon takes customer security seriously. We have developed technical measures, and we have full teams dedicated to ensuring the safety and security of our products. All voice recordings streamed to the cloud are encrypted in transit and securely stored on our servers. To allow you to review your voice recordings, we retain the recordings until you choose to delete them. Amazon says it keeps the data to improve interaction with customers. Quote, Alexa uses your voice recordings and other information, including from third-party services, to answer your questions, fulfill your requests, and to improve your experience and our services. Amazon's spokesperson noted that consumers can review all of their recordings whenever they want, but they're not the only ones reviewing those recordings. Last month, a Bloomberg News investigation found that thousands of Amazon workers around the world, real people, are listening to what you tell Alexa in your home. And with Echo devices geared toward kids, the company has been accused of illegally collecting data on children, raising concerns about safety and security for kids who keep Echoes next to their piggy banks and on their bedroom desks, particularly if there were ever a data breach or a hacking incident.
The concerns for me would be somebody hears my kids talking about what they're going to be doing after school, or they're going to be at a certain place at a certain time, and put them in a dangerous position.
It's a tricky problem for lawmakers, tech companies, and consumers. A warning for consumers to listen up as big tech is listening in. In Wilmette, Mike Lowe, WGN News.
Kind of a scary addition to that is I read an article recently where Amazon, which I did not know owned Ring, so anybody got them Ring doorbell and security things, though, you know, where so the police just, you know, said, hey, maybe this camera caught something. and went to Amazon and said, we need that video. Okay. So the companies who have these things just turning over information to government law enforcement. No warrant. No, you know, letting you know about it. No, you know. So, okay. Do you believe, try to wrap this up real quick, I only got two more pages. Do you believe that this what's called surveillance capitalism, right? They're gathering all this information so they can give you the better experience and ads tailored to you and what you want. Does this undermine our liberties? Yeah, I would say so. What's interesting is in 1984, if you read the book, you know, they have the telescreen, which can see both ways. And that was, you know, Big Brother controlling. Of course, now we have invited Big Brother into our lives. Only Big Brother is not a tyrannical government. He is a salesman promising you convenience and comfort. And so, here's the thing where it gets kind of scary. And I would actually suggest you look into it if you haven't before. China has what's called a social credit system. Where the same kind of thing is being used, all the information being gathered is actually being used to rank you socially. So, you know, you're due for a promotion. Well, you went to that place you're not supposed to be. Sorry, you don't get it. Right? Maybe you know, were due for a raise. Maybe, you know, you wanted your kid to go to that special school. Sorry, you don't have the high enough social score because of the places you've been, the things you've said. China has that. It is enacted in place in China. Now, in America, we have this natural aversion to top-down rule. However, we've already handed over information, surveillance, information gathering and surveillance ability, and we see that you have things like ESG that's at least being used in some sense in certain areas of the economy. You have areas where, like for instance, PayPal, right, payment processing, you know, service, said we're going to deny our service to white supremacists. And most people would think, well, yeah, bunch of racist jerks, absolutely. Well, who determines what a white supremacist is? Heard that word thrown around a lot lately, applying to people who aren't white supremacists? Yeah. There have been banks, major banks, who have denied funding and investing to gun manufacturers and gun sellers. Right? Meanwhile, we truck along with the I've got nothing to hide mentality. Well, except for the fact that you don't hold the right ideas. And so it hasn't come to us quite in force, but the groundwork is being laid to where, hey, conservative Christian, you have all the wrong ideas. So you don't get to rank quite as high. Okay, so what's interesting is there's all kinds of ways that social media prepare people to live a fake life. You only put out the pictures that make you look good, right? I mean, I'm guilty. It's like, okay, you know, Facebook, I'm like, okay, you know, my profile picture is 5 years old and you put a new one up. Yeah, I don't want that one. Ooh, I don't want that one, right? Put my best face forward, sort of thing. Well, what's that? Or someone else's face. Or you get one of those apps or something that cleans you up and makes you look nice, takes away the wrinkles and, you know, all that kind of stuff. So we're training to put a fake life before the public. That's what social media trains you to do. I mean, because you don't want to share all the ugly, dirty secrets out there. I mean, you don't want to tell people about that. I want to make myself look good. So that's the stuff you share. That mentality, especially whenever someone started on social media when they were young, Well, it's how easy is it now that you've just been conditioned to only put the good, right things forward to now also hide and only put forward what is acceptable? And so, how can we resist this? I know we're a little bit over, so let's try to wrap it up. How can we resist? How can we resist any totalitarian use of this? How can we resist the and survive through if this goes the way it looks like it's going? How can we resist? How can we go through it? Right, keep the information. Don't let them have it. Yeah. I mean, and unless you're going to go be off the grid entirely. Well, you know, and think about this. You know, if it comes down to where like an ESG type thing is being applied to individuals, you sure did buy a bunch of beef. That's too much meat. Lower score. You know, oh, you bought organic? Hey, bump that score up. Good for you. You know, and so you can see how this kind of thing could be used. One thing I would say is we need to actually keep a private life. There are so many people that just blast their whole life out to everybody on social media and everything else. I don't know, there's just something, what was it? There was a phrase in the, there was a phrase in the book that had to do with that, but basically that it's actually by having a private life, you're able to have liberty and freedom. By having public life and everything's out there, you're actually less free. So we actually need to keep a private life, limit what we share publicly, and I would say be known personally. Actually be in community. Actually know people who you know them and they know you. And, you know, if something were to happen because you said the wrong thing or did the wrong thing, well, your neighbors and those in your community, they know you. You know, and while there might be some who be like, oh, I'm going to have to disassociate from you because I don't want that to spill over onto me, there's still going to be those who are going to say, you know, no, I know you're not a bad guy. I know you're not a bad gal. Here, let me help you out. And so I think that is part of it as well. So. But what we definitely need to do is have a little wisdom. As Jesus said, Matthew 10:16, I send you out as sheep in the midst of wolves, therefore be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. Kind of a theme that's been going through this whole thing is for decades now, we've basically been able to have a nice, comfy life where we don't have to worry about this kind of thing because pretty much everybody agreed with us. Everybody believed basically the same thing we did. We had the same values. You know, we might disagree on a couple things here or there, you know. Right? Even, you know, 20 years ago, my Democrat friends, we could like fiercely argue about things and then laugh about it and go to the movies and, you know, whatever. You know, now everything's so divisive. Everything's so, you know, you actually cannot take for granted that people have the same views or ideas or, and so, in some ways, almost seem like you got to walk on eggshells here and there. Maybe we just need to apply a little wisdom. There's a lot of things we didn't have to think about. You know, simple things like basic rights that, you know, someone challenges the view on it and like, you know, like private property. Private property is a right. You have a right to private property. It's yours to do with, you know, what you want. It's yours. And someone comes along and challenges that, and you're like, well, because it's mine. And we don't even have a reason or a way to argue about that because we never had to think about it. Well, now we can't be quite that, I don't want to say lazy, but we actually do need to think. We need to understand, we need to consider, we need to be able to be wise in how we see things, how we view things, and how we approach things. And so, final thoughts or questions? Right. Have you noticed, and it really bugs me because most news sites will do it, I'll be reading an article and it'll refer to a tweet as a source, and then it has, you know, a picture of the tweet, or usually a link you can click on, it'll take you to Twitter. You know, it's like, really? Twitter is our sources now? Why are news agencies focusing on and sourcing what comes from social media? Because Twitter ain't real life. Yeah. Oh yeah. There have been several things that where something has happened that should be front page above the fold in everybody's face across the country. You go to like CNN or New York Times and it's, you know, buried somewhere on their website in some, you know, section that nobody ever goes to. Yeah, and so, and you know, through that they can, you know, and one thing, and I'll end with this, they can manipulate, right? In 1984, the main character, his job, he worked in the Ministry of Truth. There's your doublespeak, where what he did was actually put out the party's lies. So the party would say, "Hey, here's this," and so his job was to actually change the official archives to reflect the new thing. So if you were to go back and search, you know, the history books, well, all the history books are changed. So you don't actually have any sources to go to see what the truth was. Well, they can do that now. I mean, most people get their news digitally. There have actually been cases where I've seen, because there are some sites that archive the internet, and you can go back to the Wayback Machine, I think they call one of them, and whatever, where something changed, or they got something wrong, or whatever, and they just went in and changed the story. No retraction, no new story. They just went back and edited the old story. Change the news. Way that technology can shape what people are thinking and what's going on in society. So, okay. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you. Lord, we thank you that there is a truth, God, that you have given us your word. God, that you have given us a family, our brothers and sisters in Christ. God, I just pray that you help us to be wise, that you help us to have open eyes, that we can look at the world around us and see it for what it is, that we can see the lies, that we can see through the manipulation. God, that we can be wise about what we choose to do, where we choose to go, how we choose to act, and that in all of it, we can behave in a way that glorifies and honors you and points others to the gospel of salvation. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away.